In 1956, a truck driver named Malcolm McLean changed the world forever with a simple metal box. His standard shipping container was called ugly and soulless, and it put thousands of dock workers out of a job. But it also created the modern global economy. 20 years ago, web design got its own boring box. And just like the container, it launched a revolution that we are only now beginning to understand. So, what is this boring box of web design? It's not a metaphor. It's literally a box. To understand the revolution this box started, let's look at a very strange thing happening in design right now. I want to show you something weird. Designers today are the intellectual elite. It's fashionable to love fonts, to know everything about Helvetica, and to praise Dieter Rams and Walter Gropius, your classic intellectual snobs. But in my youth, webmasters and web designers were geeks like sysadmins. The kind of people who were equally happy tinkering in Photoshop and in HTML files. Websites were often made incredibly complex, not just for their direct purpose, but to impress each other. So where did this snobbery come from? And why did websites start to look like pages from a Swiss design book? And at the same time, another revolution was happening. Tools appeared that devalued designers. They devalued elitism and lowered the barrier to entry to a minimum. No code platforms that promised anyone could build a website. How can these two opposite trends, the rise of elitism and the rise of democratization, happen at the same time? The answer to both questions is hidden right here. This isn't a metaphor, it's literally a box. Its official name is the CSS Box Model. And this seemingly technical standard doesn't just define how 99% of websites look. It changed the social status of an entire profession. To understand the box model, you have to remember what came before. And I remember it personally. The web was chaos. We built sites with tables, used invisible spacer GIFs to move an element a few pixels. Every site was a fragile, unique kludge. It was painful. Some people see a certain romance in that, but for me, it's just traumatic memories. Then it arrived, the box model. And it brought order. It said everything on this screen is a rectangle. And every rectangle has content, padding, a border, and a margin. That's it. It was a universal, predictable law. And designers, holding such a reliable and logical tool for the first time, looked at it and realized it simplifies a complex structure into a simple canvas. And the tools for working with a canvas have been known for hundreds of years. Suddenly, it turned out that websites were basically the same as books if it was information design and posters if they were promo sites. Web design ceased to be a hacker's craft and became a subset of typography. And if so, inspiration had to be sought not only and not so much in code experiments, but in history. That's how the shift from sysadmins and videocassette digitizers to architects and industrial designers happened. And this changed everything on a social level. To be a real designer, you now needed more than just Photoshop skills. You had to understand art history, know the names of fonts, and distinguish modernism from brutalism. The barrier to entry rose, the profession became serious, and with it, so did the ego. And so the design snobbery we see today was born. It's a fascinating shift, right? From geeks to elitists. By the way, if you want to explore the sources I use to piece this history together, from old web design forums to essays on typography, I share all of that and more in my free weekly newsletter. It's a behind-the-scenes look at the research for these videos, plus other industry news. The link is in the description. So, the first part of the puzzle is solved. The boring but logical box gave birth to highbrow and predictable book-like design. It all adds up. But how did it also manage to create its antipode, the democratic no-code tools that promised to make design accessible to everyone? And why didn't that break the snobbery? Because any standard has a second, much more powerful consequence. Any standard is the first step towards abstraction. As soon as you have clear and unchanging rules, you no longer need to think about how the process works under the hood. You can build a new, simpler layer on top of it. Like how drivers are built on top of a processor and an operating system on top of the drivers and programming languages inside the operating system. Each such level is a new layer of abstraction that democratizes what came before. And after the CSS box model appeared, website coding got a stable foundation on which a new level of abstraction emerged. Visual editors, which later came up with the cool brand name, no code or zero code. Simply because the question arises, if the rules for creating a box are always the same, why write the code for it from scratch every time? No code is the box model, just with a beautiful and convenient control panel. These sliders for padding, these border settings, these containers you drag and drop, it's all just a friendly way to manage that same boring box we were talking about. No code is now associated with advanced editors like Framer or Webflow, but it all started with players like Squarespace. And here it's important to separate the concepts. Is no code blamed for boredom and uniformity? Yes. Is it fair? No. The boredom and correctness were brought by the standard itself, the book-like design we talked about in the second act. No Code didn't bring boredom, it brought noise. A huge number of low-quality, amateurish, and sometimes just plain bad websites. But this is not a failure. It is the inevitable price of any democratizing revolution. The most important thing here is not to fall for the illusion that the choice is between a good website and a bad website. The choice is usually a simple website or no website at all, and a simple, no-cost website has a non-zero chance of not being the highest quality. So the puzzle is solved. The same box gave birth to both the elite and democracy. It brought them from different directions, radically changing the landscape of internet design. But why does this pattern repeat itself throughout human history? And what does it mean for the future of each of us? The comparison with the container that completely changed logistics is not just an analogy for understanding. Because the history of progress is not a history of brilliant inventions. It is a history of brilliant standards. Behind every great leap in communication and economics lies the same two-step process, standardization and then abstraction. This is the essence of design and the essence of progress. First, someone takes a complex, chaotic process and reduces it to a single, simple, universal standard. Then, based on that standard, someone else builds a new layer of abstraction, a tool that allows millions of people to use the results of a complex process without getting into its details. In the 15th century, Johannes Gutenberg did not invent paper, ink, or even printing. His genius was in standardization. He created standard, interchangeable metal type, and based on that standard, he built a tool, the printing press. Yes, it led to a huge amount of low-quality content, cheap pamphlets, and leaflets. But it also gave us the Renaissance, the Reformation, and the scientific revolution, or our example from the beginning. Malcolm McLean didn't invent ships or trucks. He standardized the box, the shipping container. And based on that standard, the entire modern logistics system was built, a tool that allows us not to think about how a port works. Yes, it led to a flood of cheap, boring goods, but it also created the global economy. And we can include here the alphabet, USB-C, the double entry bookkeeping system, operating systems. The box model and no-code tools are not something new. They are just another manifestation of the same great pattern. The CSS box model is our standard container, and no-code platforms are our printing press. They inevitably generate noise and uniformity, but they also open up possibilities that were unthinkable a generation ago. But what happened to the world that came before? Remember the dock workers from our beginning, the ones whose unique strength and skill became unnecessary the day the first standard container arrived at the port, or the scribe from the novel The Name of the Rose, or the magnificent game Pentiment, who spent his life perfecting his calligraphy only to suddenly see the first print from Gutenberg's press. Behind every such brilliant standard, there is always a shadow. The shadow of destroyed professions and devalued skills, because progress is not only creation, it is always destruction. And it would be dishonest to talk only about the opportunities without acknowledging this price. And I myself, in a way, have gone through this. As a teenager, more than 20 years ago, I started as that webmaster geek whose value was in the ability to tame the chaos of table-based layouts. The arrival of standards and boxes devalued my skills. But it was the early adaptation to the new layer of abstraction, to no-code tools, that allowed me to stop being a webmaster and become an entrepreneur, to found a studio. Because these tools freed up my time and my mind from technical routine to think about what matters: strategy, meaning, and working with clients. In the end, it felt like I had moved up to the next floor. And today we are on the threshold of a new, even more massive layer of abstraction: artificial intelligence. It promises to automate not just technical skills, but also parts of creative and intellectual ones. And yes, it will also bring destruction and a huge amount of noise. But the pattern remains the same. History teaches us that resisting a new layer of abstraction is pointless. The only winning strategy is to understand it and climb to the next floor as quickly as possible. To start asking the questions that a machine cannot answer. After all, even the most brilliant box is empty without a great idea inside. And speaking of ideas, every week I send out a newsletter with the most thought-provoking articles and hidden gems I find online. It's designed to give you a dose of inspiration and connect the dots in the design world, just like we did in this video. It's free and the link is right there in the description. We've just understood how one technical standard gave birth to the bookish design that dominates the internet today. This aesthetic of order, minimalism, and strict rules. But to truly understand what we have gained, we need to see what we have lost, What world was destroyed by this box? What was the other completely opposite design philosophy that reigned before this revolution? That story is told in this video about the rise and fall of skeuomorphism, about a world where design tried not to be a book, but a real, tangible object. Click here to see the other half of this revolution and understand why the story of the box model is incomplete without the story of skeuomorphism.